No, no, I'd better go first. That's why I'm starting, because after she starts, I won't get a chance. So,
sorry.
See, with all the women that you have here, I'm sure you'll have more support than me. So I think I'd better take the chance whenever I can. So I think there are a few things which are unique for us today. This is the first time ever, after our wedding, of course, that we are sharing the same dais together. So that's been 30 years that we are sharing the same dais. The more interesting and more dangerous part, of course, is that there's nobody else on the dais other than us. So we have to be very careful.
Yeah, actually, we've been on the same dais, but never alone on the same dais.
Yeah, yeah, never alone on the same dais. So I thought I'd just start by saying a few words and... excuse me, sorry, I have a bit of a cold. So a little bit about IWN, and then I asked Madhu as to what you want us to talk about, because, you know, then she said, talk a little bit about your own journeys, and especially Pinky's journeys, and a few issues that we think are important from the perspective of IWN. I'm very, very excited today, very happy. Chitra, I think, you know, whatever I've heard in the last 20, 30 minutes that you've mentioned, I can tell you I'm actually thrilled. You know, for me, as for you, my journey started off in CII maybe about 25 years ago. And I had a few opportunities where I think I could really contribute. The first one was where about 15 years ago, started an organization called Young Indians. I was the founder chairman of that, and they are now spread across India, and they're doing extremely well, not only in India, but they've gone global also. And that idea was that young people in India were the future, and they should take the country into the future, and not just focus on business issues, but contribute back to the country and build a country of your dreams. And 5 years ago, when I was the chairman of the southern region of CII, you know, then this idea came up to me because of the thought that especially career women, professional women, whoever I've seen, they always come to work, go back home. They just have work and family, which is obviously extremely important, but they don't have the ability to connect across you know, different organizations like men do, and also to discuss issues which are relevant and important for them. So then I had discussed with Madhu, with Suchita, of course, was there, and said that you know, this would be a great thing to start. I had another idea at that time, that year, that we should start another thing called a Festival of South India, which is to celebrate South India and do a huge event over 5 to 6 days every year, of course. So I'm very happy that second one did not take off for other reasons, but at least I'm so happy to see that at least IWN took off. Only I'm sad that, you know, I'm not at all involved in 5 years. So when I made my application to IWN, they said my hair wasn't long enough, so I can't be a member. For obvious reasons, I can't be a member. But I'm so happy to see what you've done. I'm sure, you know, in the last 5 years, the people who I know, there may be so many other people who have contributed in IWN's growth, but, you know, hats off to your leadership and your ability to take it not only in the region, but across the country, and set the foundation. I think the foundation is the first and most important step. And once the foundation is strong, then where we have to build slowly but carefully, and then it becomes easier to build from there. So really, hats off to you. I'd like to really give you a big round of applause to you personally, on behalf of course, IWN, CII, but also on behalf of the country, because this is something that is required as far as our country is concerned. So I'm really, really excited. And Madhu also, I think, you know, supporting from the secretariat and your whole team, I'm sure they've done a fabulous job in bringing it to where it is today. So now, since my turn is over, I thought, you know, we'll start off. Initially, I thought we'll start off just talking a little bit about our personal journey together, and somehow, you know, make just talk a little bit about it. Then maybe focus a little bit more about Pinky's own personal journey, because it's all about women. And see, and my own experience with the women in my life. So maybe a few of the things, that's what we thought we'll talk about. And just one thing also I wanted to add, which I forgot, is that, as you said, IWN in a matter of decade or two can become a leading global organization. And frankly, even when we started it off, it very clearly, while CII is the parent, it has the potential to become 100 times bigger than CII for only one simple reason, because you have a market of nearly 600 million women in India, and every one of them is your potential, you know, member, potential person who you can impact, whereas CII is at the end of the day industry focused. So you have a much better market, much bigger potential, and so therefore the demand is huge. It's a question of how fast we can meet that demand. So I'll now hand over to Pinky, and if I ever get a chance to speak before this, then I'll still come back, but otherwise I'll hand it over to her to start.
You're the boss here.
A little bit about our personal journey together, and then we'll take it from there.
To start off, I really owe a lot to Sanjay for push and to CII to that matter. I think the person I am today, I owe it a lot to CII, because as a youngster of all of 20s, I was a very ants in my pants kind of a girl, never could sit in one place. I think a lot of people in the audience know me. But I think he was all very involved in CII. He was, you know, he would always take me to all the seminars, to all the events, and you know, I met so many people. I think I've grown as a person being involved in this organization. And then when he started Young Indians, I was very excited. I said, even I want to be part of Young Indians. And then he joked, and it started in my house. He's in my lawn. We had like 10 people. He had a presentation, remember? And then he said, oh, we are starting this Young Indians, and very, very passionate people. So I'm like, even I want to be a member. He's like, no, it's not a party. It's a serious organization. So then whoever were there in the group, they all vetoed him. He said, of course Pinky is going to be part of the organization. So I was heading the learning of Hyderabad chapter. And I actually, of Pan India, we won the first prize in the seminar. I don't know if you remember. I have great old memories, which Sanjay has selective memories. You remember?
Of course. I always keep joking that she's the hard drive and I'm the CPU. I'm more current. Unfortunately,
I remember a lot of unnecessary,
it's a very dangerous thing in marriage, because, you know, she says 28 years ago on that day when we went to dinner here, you told me this. So I said, okay, fine. I don't remember anything in any case. So, sorry?
Yeah. And then I remember when
luckily she knows I can't remember, so it's fine.
But luckily I don't bullshit. I'm a very honest person. So that's what I think I am. And I remember when Sanjay said we started IWN and she got Suchitra, and you know, she's going to head it. And I was like, couldn't have got a better person, because I have worked with Suchitra. We were part of 10K Run. We've done some crazy work, but had super fun. Right, Suchitra? So that's about it. So what do you want me to say?
So, I mean, our journey, we got married 30 years ago, and Pinky was very young at that time. She was just 18 and I was 23. And we went off, I was doing my graduate studies, my MBA in the US. So we went off to the US after my first semester. And we were there 1.5 years together.
We went to the US in 1 week after we got married.
And the same week when I had my exams, my final exams of my first semester. Of course, that first semester, we had 4 semesters in MBA. The first semester was my best semester. And after that, it was only a downhill. So I think the only thing which changed was obviously Pinky in my life. I don't know whether it was a diversion or a distraction. But
I think it was a fantastic experience. I would always tell anybody gets married should just get away from the family, from parents, from in-laws, from siblings, from everybody. And that's exactly what we did. And I feel we both have grown together, and we have really got our like our roots really strong together. And only we had some great fun. I learned how to cook before I went. My father said, you must learn how to cook. So I was very popular among his friends because I could make our proper Andhra meal. Only thing in the beginning, when I started off my puri and bhaji, I only burnt his hand. That is the only bad thing. I was making puris and in the bargain, burnt his hand instead of the puris. So we've had some fantastic experiences and some horrible, scary experiences also.
By accident, of course.
By accident. It would have been like wife, it's not like wife burning, it's not like husband burning. But it is great. I mean, I took some classes and I remember bought my first computer then. The Apple just came out and was super excited about that. And yeah.
So moving on, you know, when obviously I was in business and Pinky was more at home. She was more of a homemaker. So while I would be looking out and, you know, building a business, whether it's in hotels, whether it's in power plants, whether it's in various businesses, I think, you know, her contribution to that has been always significant. And in everything that I do, everything that I think of, everything that I dream of, she has a significant share of, you know, that contribution. Because, and that's one thing we always, especially, I'm sure it's with many men, that the women in their lives may play a very, very major role, but maybe may not get as much credit or due that they actually deserve. I think men are very intelligent. We try to keep that a secret because we know that women are much smarter than us. So if they start coming into the forefront, then
no,
we'll
but
have,
I have
to take
to
a back seat.
In a room full of ladies, I have to give the credit to Sanjay for whatever I am today. The two men who are responsible, his push and my father's genes. I think those two are the most important because he always made me. I did scuba diving, I did bungee jumping, I did mountaineering, I went, we went trekking. I would have never done that by myself if not for Sanjay's push. And he got me to, he is the one who introduced me to art. In the beginning, I used to fall asleep when I would keep this going to all these, listen to art. Connoisseurs, I used to get so bored, I didn't know what to do. But I think it just got into my brain. So I feel I really owe it to him for everything what I am today.
Also in Mumbai Airport, when we were developing, you know, that she played a significant role, whether it's in the design or in the art program or anything like that. So
women are good learners.
Yeah, of course, no doubt about it. I don't think there'll be many people who'll disagree with that here. So coming to maybe Pinky, maybe it's worthwhile just spend a few minutes about your own journey as a woman, and maybe you can take us.
I think
I'm trying to be a moderator.
He's my moderator today.
I'm trying
today.
To figure out what I'm supposed
Suchitra,
to do.
Suchitra, that's something which I've never had. I have.
Yeah.
Today I'm really honored to have my husband as my moderator, and he's like taking it all along. I got married very young, and as we lived in the US for 2 years, and I came back to India, and I had my daughter when I was 20 and my son when I was 22. And then Sanjay got involved in building now the Taj Deccan. Earlier it was a Holiday Inn. It was a great experience because it was like a home, and he made it really feel that way. Whoever worked with us then, even till today, connect with us, saying it was really like a big fat family. And then I think for the next 5-6 years, I grew with the children. And then I told Sanjay, do you think even I should start working? Because a lot of women started getting into work. And then it's really funny that my father has brought me up in such a way, saying women are supposed to relax. You're not supposed to work. You just enjoy, be happy at home. And then that's the way I was brought up. So to my luck, I had a husband who supported me. And then I told Sanjay, no, I think I need to work. So he's like, I come back home and I'll have stress, and then your stress will be, just enjoy life. Don't get into boring work. That's the two men in my life who gave me that kind of support. But I really thank them for that, because I'm glad if I went into the normal mainstream of the family business, I would be sitting in my office in front of my desk, not here today. I think I became a freelancer. I got into 10K run, which was very impromptu, which I didn't even know. I didn't even know how to go and ask for a penny for a sponsorship. You know, it was, I never went to the government office before that. I think 10K run really, really taught me a lot. And after that, I got into my whole philanthropy. My dad would always tell me, if you have 100 rupees, you must give 15 rupees for charity. So I always had that in me. So I was very involved in a lot of organizations. And then I don't know where this thing triggered that I'm a very lucky person. So my biggest job was cutting ribbons. I became like a ribbon cutter. For some, I don't know how it happened, but I became a lucky mascot of Hyderabad. So to my luck, the trend is going well. So far, I haven't been kicked on it. And then I think, then Sanjay felt that we shifted to Mumbai because of the airport project, and he wanted me to be involved in the whole art program. And we did this whole Bharat Yatra. He was very keen on, his vision was unbelievable. He wanted the Mumbai airport to be like a, people land in India, it should be like you're in India, not elsewhere. So we had these architects from New York, and it was just impossible for them to get it right. So Sanjay was going mad trying to, I think he must have torn like many, many plans. They were getting frustrated. He was getting frustrated. And that's when we got Rajiv Sethi. He's like the art pioneer. And we had Abu Sandeep, the designer. Then we had these New York architects. And I was the HR in the middle of all of them. We went all over the country. I saw a lot of, it was like a sightseeing, it was like an eye-opener for me. That is when I got this idea saying, why don't I, that's when I have a little business called Lotus House. It's an arts and crafts store. It's a gift store in the airport, which I pay rent to my husband. I don't have it free. I always make sure I say that because people think it's my husband's airport, I have everything easy. It's not, it's even more difficult. So we encourage a lot of artisans. So I have with the money I make from my stores, my business, I have a foundation called Aparna Foundation, which I own. And I do a lot of charity through that. And we actually, through our foundation, we have adopted a lot of artisans. It's sad to see one of the artisans we had gone to when we were collecting the art, we saw that somebody was putting their beautiful wood carving into the kitchen fire because they didn't know the value of it. They said, you know, kya hai, kuch paise nahi hai. So we have actually, my team, we identified a couple of artisans. We support them, we give them designs, we have a whole design team, we give designs, and then we buy back the product from them. So in the bargain, it's just not even a drop, it's like a speck in the ocean, but we're trying our little bit. So this is my journey, and now I have become Fiki Ladies Organization National President. That's the new thing in my feather in my cap. So that's what I say, I told in Fiki that I owe this to CII for what I am today.
A little
hand
bit
over
about
to you now.
Yes, yes. A little bit about the women in my life. You know, for me, if I may explain it in a simpler way, if I'm sailing in a beautiful ocean, then, you know, my mother has always been like the keel of the boat, where it's to do with the foundation, to keep it straight, keep it stable. She's been like, you know, where all my values came from, the aspect of being simple, being humble, being respectful, you know, some of the Indian traditions that we are all used to bringing up with. And so that was my mother. And so she's been like the keel of the boat, which kept it very, very stable. Pinky's been a little bit like my wife. Pinky's been a little bit like my rudder, where, you know, I keep obviously going in different directions just to make sure that I don't go off course, that I'm doing things which are the right things, doing things which are right for family, for the business, for society. And so sometimes, you know, we get carried away when we are not really thinking through. And so she's like, you know, making sure that I'm keeping, you know, course and not going off track. And I would like to say my daughter, who's the future, like all the young people who are here today, she's like the wind in the sail of the boat, which is really giving it all the energy and all the all the vision and the aspiration. So every one of them in a very different way have played an extremely important role in my life. And frankly, I would be nothing without them. So, you know, sometimes even in terms of simple things, like, you know, our traditions, I feel very strongly that in India, especially the younger generation, they're losing focus on, you know, what it means to be an Indian. And, you know, we have, of course, Western influence, which is very good. We can take the good of the Western influence, but we shouldn't forget what it means to be an Indian and basically our traditions, our culture. And I must thank especially the women who keep those traditions alive, who keep our foundation alive, who keep our identity alive. Even as a simple thing of even visually, you know, the way you dress, the way you think. And men, unfortunately, I keep always joking, saying that why do we always have to wear Western clothes? And especially in cities, you know, maybe sometime I will break the trend. Maybe I will, maybe not right now, but sometime where I can wear Indian clothes to office. But women that way are an exception who continue to keep our traditions. So I think, you know, that I just wanted to emphasize that, and it's not only me, I'm sure every single person, every single man, without the mother, they're nothing. And that's what is the foundation of every man. But again, I know that much, you know, there's one thinking that generally seems to be capturing the discourse today or the narrative, that not enough credit is given to women who are just housewives or an at home. I mean, I don't know why is it, it's become a trend or a social thing or a kind of a fad to say that only working women matter. But actually, you know,
Can I, 50, for 10 years of my life or even till today, I get a form and then I a homemaker. I just forget I'm a business lady or whatever, but I still call myself a homemaker. And I feel very proud to say that I'm so sometimes like meet some super ladida people. Like, oh, what do you do? I said, oh, I love to watch Kyunki Saas Bhi Kabhi Bahu Thi. I love watching all these senseless TV shows. That's my, like, you know, relaxation. They're like, oh, really? I said, yeah. I'm, you know, I do everything. But I think watching, because some people feel very shy to say, oh, I watch all the TV shows, I watch all the soaps. There's nothing wrong in saying doing that. I think it's a multiple thing. And being a homemaker, as I think, is the most difficult thing to run a home. I'm like somewhere doing something important and my cook will call me, what do you want for dinner? He will not take the, I think each one of us go through this. What do you want for dinner? What do you want for lunch? That's the story of everybody's life. And Sanjay actually used to always say when people used to say, what does Pinky do? And he would say, she takes care of the most valuable, what did he say? Huh? The most valuable assets we own. So like, what is that? Even I was wondering, what is he saying? It's our both our children. But that's so true. As a mother, I think it's so important to instill the most important values in our children. And like my son is in MIT doing his MBA. I feel really proud. I can't believe he's actually reached there. Because we've gone through a lot of ups and downs. You know, when a lot of my friends say, boys, we're going through hell with teenage children. I said, don't worry, it's a takeoff and it'll land soon. All of us have gone through it. It's not just you. So that's what I feel. Over to you.
Thank you. So I think that's in brief a little bit about us, and I don't know whether it's how relevant it is. Maybe we can open it up, Suchitra. So you want any questions or anything you want to? Anybody wants to ask?
Everything. I don't think they have any questions to ask us. Yeah. Oh, you do.
Hi, I'm Kamna from CII IWN North. I head North. Sorry, I'm late. My flight was late by an hour and a half. A question. You know, we have a lot of things happening, unfortunate things happening in India nowadays. And I think all of us here are a part of the change. We need to bring that change. And I think basically it's mindset change. You have been extremely vocal about the impact your mother had on your life. And you have been extremely vocal about how you've evolved because your parents nurtured you in a certain way. What is it that we as parents, largely cross-border socially, are doing wrong to have men in society who do torturous things? And what is it that we can do to sort of bring, whether it is in schools or, I don't know, we keep thinking on every platform, where are we going wrong? And I think all of us have this big, you know, sort of thing in our, we want the change. I think all of us here as members are here because we feel very strongly that women play a role. So can you just point out, both of you, that what are the few things that really we can do which could create a change in the mind? So I think if that happens at the first, as a mother, as a woman in society, as a man in society, a couple of things that we can take back. So that would really help.
Maybe my view is that, I'd like to go back a little bit to the history of this country. It's to do with the country and our society. I think, you know, India was a different country a few hundred years ago. And, you know, the way, even if you look at our history, our culture, our traditions, the kind of respect that was given to women in the early days, was humongous, whether it's with respect to our traditions or society, even religions also, whatever religion it is, women always played a prominent role, the role of a mother, the role of power, the role of strength, the role of education. Everything is represented by women in this country. But I think the last few hundred years, you know, something obviously, you know, that's a different debate. I don't want to go into it, whether it's because of the British or whether it's because of we coming together as a country. And so relatively after independence, we're a very young country. And I think, you know, there's so many challenges, and this is one of them. I mean, you know, that, people, whether it's to do with lack of education or it's to do with poverty not only in terms of monetary poverty, but also intellectual poverty, their exposure. You know, poverty, you know, sometimes you see street kids on the street, 5 years old, 3 years old, who are begging. Now, I don't think you can blame that kid. Many people, you know, shoo the kid away. But what does that kid know? You know, they've only born on the street, and they only know that life. They don't know anything else, whereas we are the fortunate ones. We're sitting in an air-conditioned room. So it's not an easy problem, in my view. I think, you know, poverty is number one, which is the beginning of a lot of evil. Then secondly, education is the other thing, which is, I think these two things are fundamental foundations of any country. And a lot of the problems start and emanate, in my view at least, from there. The other aspect is also, which is unfortunate, contemporary India, what is happening is, while, you know, we have to address these issues and they're really horrible, sad, I mean, we can't even begin to say what is happening, I mean, you know, how terrible it is. But everything gets politicized. I mean, you know, to such an extent that we really don't know what is the fact anymore. Between politics and media, you know, we really sometimes can't figure out what's happening. And before you know it, some other issue takes precedence. The old issue is gone. And it's not to blame anybody. I'm not blaming politicians, because I respect politicians a lot, because we don't understand what they go through when they go into their constituencies. You know, if I did that for example, my father-in-law is a politician. I tried to do 10 days I took off when he was campaigning for his member of parliament. After that, I said, I can't go there anymore. It is very difficult. So even media also, you know, so they go through a challenge. But I'm just saying, as a society, I think there is a lot of progress that is happening, which is very positive, but we can't see it. There's a lot of negativity also which comes out because of this reason. And I think, you know, we just need to move on. You know, we need to keep addressing these issues and move on fighting. We need to fight these battles every day. And we just need to keep pushing. India, you know, has a huge opportunity. It's a matter of 10, 20 years, it's going to be the leading country in the world. There is no doubt in anybody's mind. And every country in the world has problems. I mean, even if you take the US, China, you don't know what's happening there. But even in the US, Europe, every country has a problem. So I don't think we are, in that sense, unique or, an exception. But I think, you know, I see, sometimes while we have to keep addressing these issues, and that's why organizations like IWN also matter. In their own small way, everybody does matter. But I think my focus has always been saying, be positive, try to focus on what's important. As long as we become economically strong and we focus on giving good education, good health, good, you know, environment to our people, automatically these things will change, and they will change over time. These mindsets, unfortunately, are not things which will change in a day or a month or a year or even a decade. It takes sometimes a generation to change this. And that's why I think it's important that the young people, especially, you know, have the voice today, whether it's through social media or something. Today, the world is a different world. With social media, the reaction time is so quick that even whoever are the relevant people today, you know, maybe many of these people who we see who were getting away scot-free earlier, because of what India is today, they are being actually caught and they're being questioned. You know, I'm not trying to, say that it's not negative what's happened, but there's a positive element because of the way India is progressing. Maybe 10 years ago, 20 years ago, all these things were happening, but nobody, media couldn't highlight it, social media wasn't there, people didn't have the voice and strength to talk. So they were always hidden under the carpet. So I'm not saying that's a positive thing, don't take me wrong, but I'm saying that it's coming out into the open is a good thing. And so now we need to obviously address it. And I think the more it comes out into the open, more people, you know, will get disgusted, and slowly they will start changing their mindset. Sorry for this long question, but you know, this is a debate we can go on for days, but just some brief thoughts.
If I may say so, I think the world is full of, is a bag of mixed, it's a bag full of mixed things, you know. There are all kinds of people. It's not just in India, I think it's all over the world. Everywhere they're going through this. We were just talking about, we need to educate the rural men, women, children. And actually, we were having this talk in Delhi the other day in the office, and they were saying, you know that actually the worst people might be the educated in South Bombay who are having a lot of, dowry issues and husband-wife issues. You know, this that movie, that superstar. I believe it really happens. There's a lot happening like that. So I think the younger generation, as Sanjay says, are more conscious and they're ready to come out for any help and anything. And with social media, I think things are getting, it will get much, much better in our country. I think youngsters are much more passionate. They really want to come out and fight for a cause. And I think that's what I would say.
One last question, I think. Just wanted to, 30 years and counting in marriage, and the young today are disillusioned about getting married. Sorry. And the young today are disillusioned about getting married. They feel it's a piece of paper, a name on a passport. And this is, as I was coming in here on the radio, this is what I heard. I think, you know, forums like ours need to influence this institution of marriage. And I think I would love your comments, 30 years and counting.
She's too smart. She wants to know what I'll say, and then she will.
Women are always smart.
I think, you know, like anything in life, marriage is also something which has its ups and downs, has its pluses and minuses. But I guess it's all about attitude. We learn a lot from, again, seeing our parents, seeing our relations, seeing the society. And, if you go in with the right attitude, I think marriage is a wonderful institution. But today what's happening is that the younger people, their attitude is different. I mean, maybe, you know, in India we used to have this tradition of arranged marriages. It had its own positives where, you know, you go with an attitude saying we have to make it work. So that's why I think a lot of them succeeded. But today, the younger generation has a different mindset. Their attention span is very limited. If you see the impact of social, not much patience, the social impact of social media. And unfortunately, all of us are like that. You can't just wait for 10 minutes and all of us are changing. It's a changing world. So the institution also has to change, in my view. If I expect my kids to be like how we are, I doubt they will be. And frankly, my personal view is that I think as parents we teach them the right values, whatever is in their interest, I think they will do. But I think the value system to me is the foundation of everything. Now, if they believe in marriage and they believe in the institution of marriage, good. And some people may not, young people, but I don't think today, young people, it's very easy to change their mindset. I'll give you an example. My son came back from college 3 years ago, and I had a whole program saying I'll mentor him, I'll train him, I'll do all that kind of stuff. But after 1 week, I called up Keshav and I called him to my room and said, I have nothing to tell you, I have nothing to train you. As a matter of fact, I have to unlearn a lot of things that I've learned over the last 30 years. I've gathered a lot of rubbish. So you do whatever you want, I will look at you and I'll learn from you. Because kids are so bright and smart today, they are very different. And frankly, many of us don't even understand how they think. So we should give them that opportunity. Sorry, so I'm going off in a different tangent, but on marriage, it's fine. But I think, you know, it's a changing world. Kids are going to change. I don't know whether we can really make that different.
I think, Uma, you've known me from the time I was in NASA school. I really don't think I've changed much as a person, but I think I've become much more calmer, I've become more sensible, I would say. And I think being married, I've seen my in-laws, I've seen my parents, I've seen the way they've grown. And I think it's very important, one learns, adjustment is extremely important, and one should be selfless. You shouldn't keep thinking me, myself, it's not happening. You have to learn to understand the other person, your partner. Suppose I like, in today's times, like I see a lot of couples going through this. Oh, I wanted to go for a party, but my husband didn't want to go. So what, today you don't go, but tomorrow you can go, you know? You have to understand each other. There's something which is important for both of you. And in fact, a friend's daughter was getting married, and I said, you know, however great you are, I might not sound correct being in a women's forum, but I'm sure you'll agree. I'm traditional in that part, saying however great you are his wife. You've got to understand, you have to give him the respect. You have to be to his family. You can't say, I'm the greatest, I'm not going to be here anymore. Because a lot of people whom I know, their parents, in fact, I think to answer this, a lot of marriages also break because of the parents. They're like, oh my God, my daughter is really suffering there. What's the problem? Just come back home. What are you going to teach your children? I mean, you're not, you learn, you have to adjust. That is very, very important.
To put it in a different way, I learned only one thing. It took me 20 years to figure it out. It really took me 20 years to figure out one simple statement. And that is, don't ever try to change a person that you love. Accept them for what they are. I'm very, very short-tempered. So for 20 years, I used to get very angry on stupid things. Last 10 years, once I started thinking like that, nothing, you know, I'm not trying to change. You know, she shouldn't change me, I shouldn't change her. That's all. If that is itself done, every marriage will be successful. Most of the time, we're trying to change others, not change ourselves, but we're trying to change others. So with that, I think she's the right person to give advice because I think for the last 5 years, 7 years in Savvy, she has like 4 or 5 page column where people ask her questions and she gives
answers. Can you believe it? Every month I have like 2 hours, I have to sit and answer these question answers. People are asking me these, I mean, it's so sad what people are going through. You know, for us sitting here, they might think, what silly questions these are. But those are really a life change for them. So in fact, the editor, I was been writing for like 6 years. So I'm like this agony aunt kind of a person. Then I said, you know what, I think I should stop. So the editor called me and said, you know what, I just came to my office, switched on my computer, and then the first question was some husband and wife issue. And she fought with her husband and came to office. And so she said, I saw your answer and I called my husband and said, I'm really sorry for what I did. She said, there's no way you can stop. You have to answer my questions. They started with 2 questions. Now there's 7 questions. It's very exhausting. And thank you so much for having us here.
Sushitra. Thank you so much, Chitra. And I know I think we've already run over time. Thank you so much for having us.